hello. How are you? How's everybody? Welcome. Thanks for joining us. God, I love that music. I just, you know, just makes me want to dance. Okay. Well, this is where we get to talk and debate about all things paranormal, strange, and just plain weird. And from time to time, we'll have special guests joining us for those that are who investigate ghosts in haunted places, hunt Bigfoot, chase UFOs, discover metaphysical mysteries, or uncover the truth surrounding urban legends and myths. I'm Jackie Meter, Director of Central California Paranormal Investigators, and here with me is my co-host and partner, the sensitive healer and Reiki master of sacred light Reiki, Krista Erickson.
All right. Well, we got quite the show coming up for everybody.
I heard a little birdie told me something.
Uh-oh, what did the little birdie tell you?
The little birdie said, you and Half Dome have a date.
I do have a date with Half Dome. I do.
That's exciting. And this is your second time.
Yeah, it'll be my second time. The first time was a disaster.
Well, we know you got lost.
I shouldn't say it was a disaster. I actually really enjoyed it the first time, but I made pretty much every mistake that you could possibly make while climbing Half Dome, including getting lost at one point.
Well, you were a rookie.
I was.
Yeah, but now you're pro.
Yeah, and I have to show that mountain who's boss. Because last time it definitely kicked my butt. So
when are you going to do that?
September 10th is when I was. You have to enter a lottery to get a pass to climb the cables because you can't just go anymore.
Right.
And this was my first year entering, and I actually got chosen. Now, you get to choose like up to 7 days, and then depending on availability, they pick one of those days for you. So September 10th is my big day. So we'll see.
So now you have what, 3 months to train? 4 months to train?
Yeah, I have a decent amount of time to train. The last time I had like 1 month to train, and it was. I mean, it got me through it. I did it. It just, you know, it took forever. But yeah, so this time I have a little bit more time to prepare and to get ready. So I'm really excited.
Well, that's
exciting.
It's exciting. I know I had mentioned about filming you, but I thought you were climbing up the face of the mountain.
Oh, God, no. I'm not that crazy.
That's what I thought.
Not that crazy.
So I thought, well, no, I don't think I want to do this other thing. I don't think I can
do that. You mean you don't want to film 12 hours of hiking?
No.
Okay.
Not when I have to do the hiking, no.
Exactly.
If I was on a horse or something else, I mean, that would probably be better.
But yeah.
No, I can't do that.
Well, I'll have lots of pictures to share afterwards.
Oh, good. Bring some. We'll put them on the show.
Yeah, I'll do that.
Yeah, and all your scrapes and all your bruises.
I could barely walk the day after last time, so we'll see what happens. But yeah, it's exciting. But I heard you had an exciting weekend too.
Yes, we did. We got a chance to go over to the Olivas Adobe over in Ventura.
Right.
I took the team over there, and we were with Richard Sennett, who I'm sure you know.
I met him. He's amazing.
Yes. So he appeared when we had our seminar in 2008. Yeah. He was one of our guest speakers, and that's where I first met him. But then we've corresponded over the years. I've seen him a couple times. But it's always a pleasure having him with us. I think I saw my first apparition, and most people know, with the naked eye, I don't see a lot. I'm not psychic.
Right. But. Well, and something else that maybe some people don't know about you is that you're actually one of the biggest skeptics I've ever met.
I'm not skeptical. Well, I guess I am.
I guess I am. I mean, because, you know, a lot of people think that as paranormal investigators that you automatically believe in everything. But you have to have that hard evidence.
I have to have the balance.
Right.
I not only have to have the stories, but I have to have the hard evidence to match it.
And now you've had your own experience. So tell me about it. What happened?
Well,
this is exciting.
We were in the chapel part, and I'm still not sure if it wasn't a trick of my eyes. But, you know, we had lights on. It wasn't real bright, but we did have some dim lights on. But in the next room, it was dark. And through the doorway, I was kind of just panning my head and taking pictures, and I was looking at the doorway, and all of a sudden I saw something that kind of was standing in the middle, and then it moved to the side behind the door real quick.
Wow.
And it was gray. It wasn't white or black. It was gray. So I thought, okay. And so I kind of looked around to see if anybody else saw it, and then I turned my head back to look in that area again, and it did the same thing.
Wow.
Yeah.
So you actually saw it
twice. So then that's when I said something. So Vince turned his camera and pointed in that direction and left it there for about 25 minutes.
Wow.
So I'm hoping he caught something.
That is exciting. Yeah. And you haven't, this was just a few days ago, so you haven't had a chance to
review. No, we haven't had a chance to review. Okay. So, but yeah, that was the first time. If it was an apparition, then it was, you know, I checked car headlights and all that stuff, and there was no way. It wasn't white, it was gray.
Yeah.
So that would rule out a lot of things, flashlights and all that kind of stuff. So,
but, exciting.
Yeah.
I can't wait to see what your evidence produces.
Yeah, I know.
Okay.
But anyway, you haven't noticed our little...
Oh, I noticed.
Yeah.
I noticed. Do you want to introduce our friend?
This is Mr. Boo Buddy. And if I can get a close-up on him. Yeah, this is Boo Buddy. This came from GoStop.com, which is Paul Bradford's website. He and six others have a shop where they make equipment. Okay, and this is Boo Buddy, and I've been wanting one ever since I saw it advertised. Just give you a little kind of, and it's going to take a few seconds here before it to warm up. But yeah, we actually used it at the investigation, so we're hoping, we haven't reviewed our recordings yet, but we're hoping that we pick up something.
Okay.
So, what he's doing now, he's taking almost like baseline readings, and it's actually pretty far out. I think Paul said it's like 25 feet.
Oh, that's a good size. So it gets a whole room.
It gets a whole room. Yeah. So, yeah.
Hi,
so,
I'm Boo Buddy. What's your name?
Yeah, so it's actually a prompter. It can be used as a trigger, but when it detects changes in disruptions in the EMF field or changes in the temperature or any kind of motion, vibrational changes, it will react, say something, and then hopefully prompting the spirit to answer back. And I think that's cool.
Now, from what I understand is that this isn't necessarily a tool that you sit down with. This is something that you put in a room.
Right.
And you leave it there by itself so that you can go off and go investigate other areas.
Right.
I don't know if you guys heard it, but just a second ago it said, "Hi, my name is Boo Buddy." I'm going to hold them up to the...
Did you say something? Could you please say it again?
Hopefully you heard that. So what he's doing is he's actually asking questions.
Whenever there's a change, like say EMF, motion, or temperature, it triggers him to respond.
That's so cool.
And then you put him a recorder here or a video camera on him, and then so that you collect any answers that come back, you can record. So
that's really cool.
Yeah, it is cool. I kind of liked it. Boo Buddy. Yeah, we got to write a song.
I know. The reason why you got this is because we actually had quite an exciting weekend. So as some of you know, Jackie and I took our show on location to Allensworth in Early Mark, California for the Ghost Hunters International Reunion last month. For those of you that don't know, GHI was a series offshoot from the original Ghost Hunters TV show. And it aired from 2008 to 2012. The show featured Barry Fitzgerald, Paul Bradford, Joe Chin, Scott Temperman, Chris Williams, Susan Slaughter, and a few others who appeared over that four-year period. This reunion event brought the GHI boys, Barry, Paul, and Joe, together again. And, well, you're going to see exactly why we had such a great time, because... This was a lot of fun. These guys, they are funny. They are easy to talk to. It was just such a fun day.
I was surprised that these boys, who are really worldly known, and they were so friendly.
They really
were. They were so gracious. They were just very cooperative. The attitude was just... one of just overall nice, you know. I mean, you couldn't have asked for a nicer bunch of guys, three guys, to kind of just sit down with and kind of just hang out with. And they did. And I saw them move around to other people and kind of hang out with people and laugh and joke around. And,
right.
You know,
I
and
agree.
Stuff.
It was really laid back and just very casual. Yeah. The whole thing was very casual, which you're right. It's different from a lot of other conferences.
Right.
And it was just, it was great.
They were very gracious and they were very just, I mean, no matter what we wanted them to do, didn't hear a complaint, didn't hear anything negative.
Yeah.
They were wonderful.
Yeah, we were out there in the hot sun, sweating buckets.
There
was no complaint
at
all.
Awful.
It was wonderful.
And speaking of the hot sun, we had a chance to sit down before the actual conference began and kind of do an informal, off-the-cuff interview. Just the five of us hanging around. And the only rule we had was that there was no swearing allowed. After all, we're still a family show.
And that was so difficult.
It was difficult. It was difficult for one of them. I'm not going to say which one. But it was difficult for one, because that's pretty much every other word he says.
Yeah, exactly.
But anyway, but again, they were very gracious. And anyway, we've got a clip. So let's take a look at Leia.
Let's
take a look at the first clip.
The Allensworth Township, a small farming community in the Central California Valley, was founded in 1908 by Lieutenant Colonel Allen Allensworth and others, and was dedicated to improving the economic and social status of African Americans. Here, 250 people once lived and thrived in a community free of segregation. Many residents who escaped the horrors of slavery and moved to Allensworth said it was like going from hell to paradise. The town's economy depended on agriculture. Farmers cultivated alfalfa, wheat, sugar beets, and cotton, raised dairy cattle, chickens, turkeys, and Belgian hares. The town had several businesses and public buildings, a bakery, drugstore, livery stable, barber shop, church, school, general store and post office, library, machine shop, and a hotel. In the beginning, water was abundant from artesian wells, but by 1912, problems from the declining water table throughout the area helped to doom the community. By the 1950s, Allensworth was an impoverished area without drinkable water, and with all of the residents gone, it became a ghost town, with a living population of zero. A campaign that began in the early 1970s to save Allensworth finally saw it successfully become a state park in 1976. The restoration and reconstruction began, and now the preserved town site features 9 restored buildings, including the schoolhouse, hotel, general store, and several homes. The Allensworth State Historic Park is a significant monument and public park dedicated to the memory and spirit of Colonel Allensworth, as well as a place to note the achievements and contributions of African Americans to the history and development of California. On March 14, 2015, the Porterville Ghost Society hosted an event at the Allensworth State Historic Park to bring together Barry Fitzgerald, Paul Bradford, and Joe Chin from Ghost Hunters International for a reunion. And Paranormal Journeys was there to talk with the boys from GHI.
Down and deep and maybe a little dirty, you know?
Maybe a little. Not too dirty. Okay. Still PG, guys. Maybe PG-13.
We're going to ask the real rough questions.
They won't be that rough. We'll be gentle. Yeah, we'll promise.
Oh, my God. Sorry, that's what she said.
All right, guys. So what do you think of Allensworth so far?
I love Allensworth. I've been back here several times. It always has great activity, especially as the sun starts to set. We are out in the open. We are on a very, very warm day. Yeah. It's going to be a little rough on us.
I think it's a full moon. Was it a full
midday.
Moon tonight? I think it's a full moon.
I don't know. I don't know. I thought the full moon had passed.
I don't know. I think it's close.
The thing about full moons, they come back.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll make it happen. That's Kat.
Kat will make it happen. Kat will make it happen.
Yeah, she can make everything happen.
That's a different kind of moon.
Right.
So I'm curious, what's on your bucket list? You've done everything already so far. So it's like, you got something out there that you can share?
Actually, yeah. I've never been to China. I'd like to go to China. We were supposed to do it a couple times, but it got canceled.
Oh, okay.
And then in the States, there are a lot of places that's still on my bucket list. The Stanley.
Yeah.
Eastern State Penitentiary. Yeah. Places like that, that's still on my bucket list. Yeah. There's so many places that I can't even list or mention.
Yeah. Cool. All right. Paul, what about you?
Yeah, I mean, there is obviously always going to be places. The thing with what GHI really gave us is an opportunity to investigate particular locations that we'd never even heard of. You know what I mean? And it was one of those things where, like, now I've done it, it would have been on my bucket list had I have known even the place existed. places like the ATM Caves in Belize. So I never even knew that place existed. And, you know, I was able to really be Indiana Jones for a week.
Be Indiana Jones.
Growing up, I wanted to be James Bond or Indiana Jones. And I think that one, you know, with the exception of a giant ball chasing me out, that was the closest I think I'd ever be to Indiana Jones.
Did you carry a whip?
I wasn't allowed.
Oh, oh, you weren't allowed, so you actually asked at some point.
Yeah. I think our hands were full because we had to carry little plastic bags everything. In which you had to urinate and poop into the bags.
Oh. Yeah. That would be uncomfortable. how little were the bags?
Well, Joe, I think they were about that. I just hope that you didn't slip and fall off.
Well, I said, how am I going to get my cheeks on that? That's so tiny.
The thing is, the lunch bag was the same.
A true, you take out what you bring in.
Exactly, yeah.
Pack up your trash.
Wow, I bet that was a whole new experience.
It was an experience. It was grueling for me. It was very physical because towards the end, it was kind of like a travel adventure show / ghost hunting show.
It was, right.
And it got very challenging physical because I'm not the most physical kind of guy. But yeah, you had to hike 3 miles into the jungle, cross 3 rivers, you get to base camp, you had to climb down a ravine, swim 25 feet into the cave with all your gear on, and then spelunk in the cave.
I think that was what was fascinating about the show. It wasn't just the ghost hunting, it was the different places, at the trek that you had to get there, and then the experiences, the personal experiences, other than the paranormal that you had there. I mean, the bag.
You kind of missed out on a lot of that, though. I mean, when it came to the editing, you kind of missed out on the adventures. Yeah, I mean, it was. There were a lot of cases where it was an adventure getting to the investigation, and then that was one of those things which we were always disappointed about. I mean, to see it was we had no control over editing at all. I mean, a lot of people think that we're there from start to finish as far as the episode is concerned, but really we control the investigation. But outside of that, what's filmed, they can edit it. So it's like, you know, that particular case, again, that's one that they had like 500 hours of footage.
And they
put it down to a 20-minute investigation. I mean, you missed out on so much on that one.
And folks, we are not in control of the music that's played in the show.
The sound effects?
We get so many emails, turn the music down. It's too loud. We can't hear what you're hearing. Of course, it's not up to us.
Yeah. We don't actually wear like music packs with us while we're traveling.
But you're right, because the general public, they don't know that. No. They, you know, they think you guys are totally in control. And, you know, I hear that all the time. But no, the producers, and that's why a lot of groups aren't doing the TV anymore. They're fed up.
I think from our standpoint, during the daylight hours, We always met the TV crew head on. We got those shots that we needed.
Yeah.
But once it came to nighttime, it came to the investigation, then the crew played to our tune. And that's the way it should be.
Sure.
Sometimes maybe that's not always the way.
Well, producers have the ultimate word. So, I mean, you know, that's just bottom line. It is what it is.
So let me ask you this. Do you guys feel that the show was ever sensationalized? That it was made to be more exciting than it was, than it really was?
I thought the show could have been more exciting with the editing.
Yeah.
Because as Paul has pointed out, we did have challenges. Yeah. We had physical challenges that were not addressed. That, you know, whenever we go to some South American countries, we were there for a week, waiting to get our equipment because it was seized. And you know, you're constantly going through that. And in the meantime, I've got these guys trekking up the side of a live volcano, sandboarding down it. So, you know, we took the opportunities to do that. Although I must add, the insurance company never knew we were doing that.
No, did you guys take home movies of all that stuff? So is at some point later on you can do, a documentary or whatever?
I took a lot of video and a lot of photos.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Put it together, put a documentary, because I would, number one, would be fascinated. I think a lot of people would be fascinated. I mean, not just hunting ghosts, but getting there and trying to do what you do on TV.
Yeah. I mean, I think we would have loved it to have been a show about the adventures of, you know, not just getting there, but, you know, the investigation. That we would have loved that, but the thing is, with the way that GHI was, it was a spin-off.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Right.
And it was a cookie-cut format. I mean, you watch the show, they have, you know, you see us in the cars, we do the download of the investigation, we get to the location, we do the tour, and then we go into investigation mode, we go into the, everyone sits around the table with headphones on, and then you're doing the reveal. It was very much a format which the production company were very scared to come away from.
And whenever we did finally start to push our way, ourselves away from that particular format, we started to find our feet, and we were really starting to move into areas that were, you know, physically challenging for all of us. Yeah. But they were absolutely fantastic and thrilling adventures.
Oh my God.
But of course,
I would love to hear all of them.
it came to the end, that was that. I know after we had finished filming in October 2011, I flew down to Singapore, and I found us locations down there that, you know, we thought that we had challenging locations before, but I was intending to take us underwater into the sea, and of course across Joe, across the Great Wall of China, to a location there where voices beckon people into the desert, and they just simply don't come back. And so, you know, we were wanting to investigate those and really spread our wings, but we were clipped.
Right.
Okay, Barry, so what's on your bucket list, the top bucket list?
Well, I've got, since, as Paul has mentioned, the caves in Belize, my research has taken me on a different path, to start investigating and analyzing and understanding what our ancient civilizations were doing. And looking at these ancient doorways that they were using to open from one world to another, now we're understanding how they were doing it, what they were doing, and why the buildings were very, very key in this. And we also seen this this research crossover from Belize into Peru, where we went to a location up there, which was again very, very challenging for us because of the altitude was tremendous for us.
And the falling out of trucks.
And the falling out of moving vehicles.
Oh, who fell out of a truck?
That's another story. Really?
Yeah.
Well, what happened was, I mean, it was a trek through the for the Andes. We were driving through the Andes. I mean, it was like a three-hour drive, I think. It was a good solid drive. And Barry and I are both photographers, and so, I mean, literally, you could just point a camera anywhere around there and get an amazing photograph. So, rather than sitting in the truck, we decided to sit on the back of one of the pickups, and we traveled through the Andes taking photographs and things like that. Well, the driver just stopped for no reason. So we're just sitting there after about, you know, 10 minutes, you're like, what the hell is going on here? So I stand up, and as I stand up, that way, he decides he's going to pull away.
Oh,
so,
of course.
I left a mark, I'll bet.
So Paul rolled out the back of the vehicle, and I turned to the cameraman standing beside me and said, no one's going to believe that I didn't push him.
Did he push you?
No.
Oh, okay. You should have said yes.
No, he paid me enough to say no.
Oh, gotcha.
I've been listening since we've got here, that all of the little stories you guys have, and who's the ultimate prankster?
Well, that's Fitz.
Yeah.
Really?
But he's the most, no. He's the instigator.
Oh, okay.
I mean, there's times where I've instigated some pretty good ones, but Fitz, he's the one who, in fact, I do have a video when I do my presentation. You'll see a video, and it's all Fitz. I mean, he sets it up.
Oh, is that New Zealand?
Yeah. Yeah. He wakes up Joe, and Joe, I'm not going to spoil it because the presentation later is
it's pretty funny.
It's funny as heck.
That was really good, though.
That was a fantastic one.
And also in Sweden, whenever we were driving through Sweden, you had fallen. Paul falls asleep at the drop of a hat.
I get a lot of Irish art on my face.
So as I'm driving,
Sweden?
And I would take the Sharpie and just start drawing patterns on his face.
Oh no!
And we arrived at the hotel, and the crew, everyone had seen it, but we didn't say anything.
No.
And of course, Paul runs into the hotel lobby, full of all these posh guests.
Right up
to reception, and they're looking at him strangely. And he still doesn't twig on. He wonders, what the hell are they looking at? And as he goes to get his room, the elevator doors close, and he sees his reflection.
Oh, no.
There was profanity mentioned, but I shan't say it here.
Yeah. But, I mean, he says Sweden, but there was the Ukraine, Poland, Estonia.
You know he's right.
There was a lot of times. And then I realized, you know what, now what I need to do when I wake up
is look in the mirror or the reflection of the car. I used to carry wet wipes now just to clean my face.
But Sharpie is not easy at all.
Otherwise, no.
If you just try licking your hand, it just turns gray. Yeah. Harvey Two-Face right there.
Aye.
I had that a lot. All drawings on my arm. That was getting insane.
Yeah.
Well, they just go with your tattoos. Getting,
yeah, they did add to my tattoo. Yeah. You remember that one, right?
Oh, yes,
yeah. Yeah. This is family show.
People's anatomy started appearing on your tattoos.
Right, exactly.
Yeah. If he's going to take you on a trek,
it will be
a trek because he says, I'll show you Paris. We walked and saw Paris in 4 hours, which is
all of Paris in 4 hours.
Pretty much, we walked everywhere.
You didn't get down underneath all the catacombs.
We did.
I did the same thing with London.
He would trick me, just a few steps further.
Yeah, right.
That's okay, I can handle walking.
Just get that road over there, we'll be good.
Isn't there an Irish saying, it's just a stone's throw?
That's it.
Yeah, just a stone's throw.
You've got a good arm.
A good walk, a good stretch of the legs. A good stretch of the legs. That's what it is. Yes.
Is it just time to get out of this heat?
Silence.
Let's get out of the heat. Let's get away from these.
Yes, let's get out of the heat. Get some water.
I'm lost for words.
Oh my God, is this a first?
Yeah.
The silence.
I'm completely thrown off
of that. Hey, thanks, guys.
That was so much fun.
The poop bags. I think there were two stories that they told us that whole day, and that kind of really stuck in my mind as being hilarious, and that was one of them.
Absolutely.
It was like, I understand the reasoning. You know, right. You go into these ecological fragile zones, and you want to make sure that it's preserved. You know, you don't want to contaminate the site. So I understand the reasoning, but gee, you know.
The poop, could you imagine?
And then have it the same size as your lunch bag. Ew.
Ew is right. It was so much fun sitting down and just getting to hear the stories behind the show, because I think, like, and we'd mentioned it during the interview, but you miss so much.
Right. Right.
From the editing.
Yeah, and it's just, from the editing, right, yeah. And even when they edited their shows, and we talked about how, I mean, I would love to see not only the ghost hunting section, mm-hmm. but the history behind what they're doing there, but how they got there they had stories about their hotel rooms and the things they did while they were waiting for their equipment to show up,
right.
And you know, and then the treks they had to get to the site. I mean, it wasn't all by fancy limousine and airplane and helicopter. You know, it was all walking and climbing and you know. So, yeah, I would love to see those pictures and those videos and those commentaries.
Absolutely. That was, I think, more interesting than the end result.
Well, and such a great bunch of guys. I mean, you know, they're just so open, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And friendly.
And this was really the first time we had met these three.
Right. Right.
And we had met him briefly, introduced ourselves, said hello in the hotel when we arrived. But then it was straight out to film that. And mm-hmm. it was so comfortable. It was so easy to just sit and talk with them.
Right, right.
And that just kind of set the mood for the entire day.
Right.
It was really great.
So shall we watch the second clip?
Yes.
Let's watch the second clip.
Okay.
I think we've moved to the church where the actual conference started. Okay.
Yeah, because it was hot outside.
Yeah, it was hot outside.
And bugs. We had to go inside.
Yes. You all know them from Ghost Hunters International. They are Barry Fitzgerald, Paul Bradford, and Joe Chin. Please welcome,
guys.
Give them a good hand, folks.
Hello, hello.
One in. 1, 2, 3. Right there, Joe, right there. All right. Aren't
Welcome
they looking
back,
good? Aren't they looking good? Okay. We're going to do a few questions, and then we're going to get some audience questions. All right. Krista, you want to start?
Sure. How are you guys doing?
Awesome.
Good. Right, yeah. An easy question. Okay, we'll start easy.
No, that was it, wasn't it? How are you doing?
Oh, that's right. It was. Okay. Well, how about this? How did you guys all get started with Ghost Hunters International? Let's start there. Let's start with the basics.
From my aspect, I got a phone call because I was part of the Ghost Hunters episode that came across to Ireland. Mm-hmm. We filmed at Lepp Kessel and Lachine. And that was it made great viewing figures. And the idea came across then of doing an international show. And I got a phone call from LA to say, look, we're doing an international show. Would you consider being part of it? You travel the world, someone else's dime, and investigate all these different experiences. I did think about it. I did give it some consideration, all of about 2 seconds, and said, yeah, I'll do that. So that's how I got
to see involved. The world. Oh yeah, jump at that chance.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. For me, I worked at a retail store, computer retail store, and Jason and Grant used to come in and buy equipment. Well, they became one of my customers, and months later, I asked, well, I appreciate your business, but what do you guys do with all the stuff you buy? Oh, we're doing a TV show. I'm like, well, yeah, they're looking in Rhode Island. I said, Rhode Island, so tiny. What are you gonna do in Rhode Island? He said, we're gonna look for ghosts. I'm like, what? Did you say ghost? He said, yeah. I said, I didn't know people look for ghosts. He said, yeah, there's groups of us that go around to help people determine if their house is haunted or not. And I was like, wow, I didn't think that was something anybody did. So we became friends, and at his Halloween party, he says, I've got a team that's not gonna be on television, but you can get a taste of paranormal investigation if you're interested. So I said, yes. And after two investigations, I was hooked, loved it. You know, you get to hear some creepy things, you get to go in houses and dark areas and investigate. And then again, the following year at his Halloween party at his house, he got a call from Los Angeles asking if he knew anybody. And said, we're looking for a new guy for the international, and who do you recommend? And he said, probably Joe. Well, at first I turned it down because I wanted to stay in the safety of the United States. I said, it's safe here. It's out crazy outside in parts of the world. So I turned it down, but they kept after me. They wow. called and emailed and said, talk to your family, see what they think. My family was like, what are you kidding? You get to travel the world and do what you like looking for ghosts?
And get paid for it.
And get paid for it, yeah. So I said yes. So I'm glad I did because it's been the time of my life. I loved it. Loved it. Still love it.
I can't believe he had to think about it. I would have been like Barry, 2 seconds,
no,
okay, I'm in.
I was like, no, there's crazy people out there. Did you see those wars in those countries?
I think I want to start working in a computer store.
Seriously?
Yeah.
Seriously?
There's not many of them left, though, is there?
No.
I just realized something. Joe actually called us crazy.
They're not crazy.
A little bit.
A little bit.
Oh, okay.
No, we're all crazy.
Well, I mean, I think we can all admit that to be a ghost hunter, you have to have a little bit of crazy in you to even
you know,
want
6 hours
to do
in the
this
dark
in the first
with no
place.
Bathroom out in the middle of nowhere.
Right,
yeah,
exactly.
Okay.
So how did you get started, Paul?
I mean, as far as sort of the GHI element of it, I mean, I was in America. I was actually working on my green card and all that. So, really?
Did anybody catch that? No.
Can you do it again? I'm doing. I'm working on my green card and my work permit and all that sort of stuff, so I can actually earn some money in the U.S. My brother-in-law at the time was actually part of a
Aww.
So I remember my first day. I was just part of a TV group. TV group? No, I wasn't. I was part of a paranormal group in Arizona. And it became very obvious very fast that tech was expensive. And back then, I mean, there really wasn't anything out there for us. I mean, everything was basically, I mean, we had two cameras. One of them wasn't even night vision. And we had a baby monitor. Because that was night vision and wireless. Yeah.
And we all got to start somewhere.
It was so high tech, it was amazing. Yes.
Oh,
yeah, one of the cameras actually had a flashlight on the front of it, so that was our night vision at that point. It became very obvious very fast that we needed to really sort of look at alternatives as far as sort of increasing our arsenal. And so I started, you know, researching online and coming up with some ideas and things like that. And then I started building infrared lights, the geophone, the vibration sensors, things like that.
And I was building all this stuff, and I got picked up by a couple of these blog talk radio shows who wanted to interview me about the stuff that I was building. And then one day I get this phone call from a guy who ran a website called paranormalnews.com. I don't even know if it's around anymore. But he calls me and says, hey, the guys from Ghost Hunters are looking for you. And I was like, who did I piss off? First of all, who did I upset at this point? And so I was like, okay, why do they want me? And so anyway, I get this phone call and it says, hey, you know, we can't tell you what the show is, but would you be interested in you know, being part of a team of paranormal investigators? I was like, yeah, of course. And then, you know, I assumed it was gonna be a pilot because at the time there was a bunch of these new shows just popping up. When I joined, there was that Extreme Paranormal and I can't remember. There was a bunch. There was that Ghost Lab as well. I think that was around as well. And they were all just starting up. So I assumed it was going to be this pilot. And I did the interview. I did. That was random as well. I had to film myself while they were asking me questions on a speakerphone. And I was in. It was so random and odd. So he's asking me questions. First of all, he says, "What's that thing in your eye?" Oh, it's. He goes, he's like, "Is that a mole or a piercing?" I'm like, "It's a piercing." I was like, it can come out. I don't really want it to because it freaking hurt when it went in. I don't remember how much this one hurt going in. I was really drunk. And it was with a push pin.
Oh. Oh. Ew.
Yeah, we are crazy.
Yes.
Yeah, we are crazy.
But eventually you got the filming done and they said, for some unknown reason, they said, yeah, we would like you on the show.
I think it's because I had an accent. They're like, oh, he's got an accent. That's really international.
is he really full of himself?
Yeah. I said, well, here's the thing. There was already six people on the team and then they bring in a seventh just because I had an accent. They pulled me in as Barry's friend.
But I kept my subtitles.
Yeah, I know there's a joke in there somewhere. Yeah, yeah, an inside
there was
joke.
There was an ongoing thing between Barry and I as who gets subtitled first. Like, who's going to be subtitled on this episode? Because for whatever reason, we never got subtitled at the same time. And there was countries like Scotland and Jamaica where the client was had the thick accent, yet we still got subtitled. I never understood that.
It's so fascinating how these guys got started. It's not like none of them.
They didn't know each other.
Right. Well, and none of them tried to get on a show.
Right.
They were all contacted because they happened to know the right people.
I think so.
But just how cool that they came together that way.
It's just luck of the draw. But you can see by the chemistry between the three of them, and they're just phenomenal together.
They really are.
You know, I mean, I haven't seen Scott Tepperman or Susan or Chris with them, but, you know, off away from the show, but... These three, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if they made a business out of doing these reunions once a year.
Seriously,
you know?
They could. They really could because they're so great together and they're fun. We're gonna keep showing some more clips from the interview that we did with them, and it just gets better and better.
Yeah, I know. Meanwhile, we're gonna talk about we're gonna show the next clip, and I'm gonna play with my boo buddy.
All right, guys, what was like your most favorite location?
Oh my God! I think for me it would definitely have to be Belize. Mm-hmm. Belize had there were fundamental cornerstones from that country that and those investigations that set me onto the path that I'm on now, that to me was fantastic. Really, the pinnacle for me was there. Of course, Peru was a sharp second when we had to fly into this valley. And the plane was sideways coming in. And I thought, this is impossible, it's never going to land. And we're in something the size of a baked bean tin, all crammed in. It was like a clown car with wings.
Yeah.
And
fishtailed and it dropped and I thought I was going to die. I'm gripping the bag with the vomit bag ready.
And we all made it. And then we were challenged then with altitude sickness as well that we had to compete against. And strangely enough, it had the opposite effect on me because I bounded up the mountain like a jackrabbit.
Like a jackrabbit, bouncing open. I took three steps, I'm like...
So would you agree with that assessment, Joe, that those are the best two places?
For me, it was Belize and probably the castle where I was bitten. Mm. I have never experienced anything like that. We were in Denmark, Castle Dragsholm, and I was investigating in a small dungeon, dirt, and then we got nothing out of it. We were like, it's kind of boring. Let's go to another part of the castle. So up the stairs I go. My arm starts to burn and sting, and I'm like, it's really stinging and burning. So we get to the top of the stairs, I pull my sleeve up and there was teeth marks. I'm like, that's teeth marks? What the hell is that? Four teeth, a space, another tooth. Took me a while to let it soak in, but that was paranormal wise.
Fantastic client there that was showing us around. And I have to say, he threw a question at me that I wasn't quite sure how to answer. Because one of the hauntings originated from the fact that he poisoned his daughter and then bricked her up in a wall. Mm. So we were able to look through this hole in the wall and there were her remains. Mm. So she was alive whenever she went in. But he turned to me and said, it's a good way to kill your daughter, isn't it? to which my brain, of course, was cycling through, how really do I answer this? To which he came back and said, isn't it? And I thought, well, I suppose if you really had to.
Yeah, it makes you question the sanity of the person asking that question in the first place and whether you want to cross that line of offending them or not.
Paul, what about you? What was your favorite?
Other than the caves in Belize, because again, I mean, that was my Indiana Jones moment. But I think Australia was probably one of the ones. At that point, that Australia for me was two things. It was one, I had actually been told that I'm officially part of the team. And two, I went and did a solo investigation in the morgue. Yes, we are crazy. It was eventful. There was footsteps around me. There was footsteps on the gravel outside. There was glass bottles moving in the laboratory next to me. There was this particular cold spot that was isolated to this hole in the wall. There was a lot of stuff going on that for me. This is what I was looking for in Arizona. I'd go to these residential investigations and do these investigations, and from them we barely got anything. I mean, there was perhaps a voice or something, but I'm in this room, I'm on my own, and there's this just crazy stuff happening. I wish that something had shown itself at that point, but other than that, I had an amazing experience, and you know, that to me is why we do what we do. As well as obviously looking for answers, we do this for the experience, and that's one that I won't forget.
Plus, we also got to chase kangaroos, herds of kangaroos.
That was amazing.
In golf carts.
You were in golf carts chasing
it was
herds.
It was, well, like Jurassic Park.
It was.
With kangaroos, yeah.
The funny thing about that is that actually what it was is sci-fi America.
Why is this?
It's always when you talk.
Yeah.
What is with that?
Wow, I'm being picked on here. Wouldn't be a first time. So, but basically what was happening, Sci-Fi America, Sci-Fi Australia came out.
Made a big mistake.
Huge mistake. They said, hey, we need to do an interview with you guys. So we've actually hired a golf course.
And
an open bar. An open bar. And those three keys there, that's for the three golf buggies out back. Really? So they took Rob to go and interview Rob, and left us with an open bar and golf cart keys. So after, I mean, we were going to take, we took advantage of the bar quickly, like, quick. And so we went, and so I think, Joe, you was with me, weren't you? Right, so I was, yeah, you with Dustin.
Yes.
And the girls kind of did their own thing at that point, but basically, Barry and I were driving, and we was like, oh, there's kangaroos. Now, to set this up, Rob's doing his interview, he's standing there in front of the camera, and his words were something along the lines of, it's great to be in Australia, it's great doing all this and seeing the history and that, and then he sees these kangaroos, and he says, and of course, it wouldn't be Australia without the kangaroos. And so as he pans around, there's this herd of kangaroo, two golf buggies. To that he went, and there's the rest of the team. It was Jurassic Park. It literally was brilliant. And you'd think that was all planned, but it weren't.
We just got drunk and found some golf carts. You know, I'm terrified of Australia. I don't think I'd ever go to Australia.
Why?
Have you seen all the YouTube videos out lately? There's like octopus crawling out on land, grabbing crabs and sharks and snakes. I'm like, mm-mm.
You watch sci-fi too
much. Have you seen the bats that they have there? They're like as big as me.
Oh, but they really are cute. The fruit bats are fantastic.
If you say so.
They're bigger in America, Samoa. We thought they were like vultures, but they come out in the day as well. Yeah. Do you remember those? They were bats, right? We thought they were vultures. We're like looking at them and goes, oh no, fruit bat.
Yeah, but they're huge. They're like they can get like 5 feet tall, I think, right?
Also, like 5 foot tall bats.
Right, yes. Yes, that's what I'm talking about. These aren't
Are you high?
Bats. No.
5 foot tall bats.
Thank you for asking, though.
She's seeing Dracula.
I am. Does he look like Gary Oldman?
You know what? He kind of did.
5 foot, you don't be standing, I mean, wingspan maybe, but standing up.
When we actually air this, I am going to make sure Jackie inserts a photo of the bats that I'm talking about, because I am not making this up. I am not waiting.
I'm 5 foot.
Oh, I know.
Okay.
A bat that big?
Yes.
Tall.
B.A.
Tall.
Get out.
Tall.
You don't mean wombats, do you?
No.
Okay.
No. Oh my God, right. I remember. You've just reminded me of the dam. Little tiny thing kangaroos.
At your door.
What the hell are they?
I don't know. Oh, the Tasmanian devils.
No. They were wombats, tiny kangaroos.
Wallabies.
Wallabies.
Yeah.
The hotel that we were staying in had windows on the ground floor that were level with the ground. Mm-hmm. So at night, I had biscuits and I could open the window and Joe was next door to me. And Joe had no idea I was doing this. I was feeding the kangaroo things. I was feeding them biscuits. And they were all coming in droves. I had no idea where the hell these things were coming from. But I was feeding them biscuits. And then, of course, I ran out of biscuits and said, okay, that's it, done. Everything's nice and friendly. Closed the window. Well, these things started a riot. They started beating the windows, wanting more biscuits. And of course, Joe woke up going, what the hell's going on? Pulls open the curtains and there's these things looking at him.
Don't feed the wallaby biscuits, folks.
You know, I would love to go to Belize. I mean, that cave, I actually found a picture. I'm not going to put it up because it's copyrighted, but I actually found a picture of actually him in this kind of like small lagoon and he's entering the actual cave.
That's really cool.
That goes underground, yeah, mm-hmm. That they were talking about. So, yeah, I'm talking about Barry. So
yeah, I can see why that would be one of their favorite places.
Yeah, yeah.
But I got to defend myself here.
Go right ahead.
Johnny, please. Johnny's inside our control room right now. Could you bring up that photo? There it is.
And that
see,
is.
I was not lying or exaggerating.
It does look as tall as me. And you can see the man there standing next to him. And he's probably on the smaller side, maybe 5.5 feet, whatever.
Yeah.
But I'm 5 feet, and that's definitely as tall as me.
That thing is huge. That is why I don't like Australia. And not only that, but and technically it's considered a flying fox.
Correct.
But come on, that is a bat, people.
Well, the reason it's a fox is because they actually don't have night radar to hunt at night. They're fruit bats, but they actually hunt by sight. So they're a little different than the night flying bats. So because that's why they hunt in the daytime.
It is a bat.
You're right. It is.
But I had to make sure that we got that photo in here because I was not exaggerating.
Well, that's for you. But yeah, I would have loved, and then of course, I wouldn't mind going to Australia. I would love to go to Australia.
You know,
I keep you out of caves, I promise.
I would have to go to, you know what? There is no place I wouldn't go. Let's be honest. Right. There's no place I wouldn't go.
You're pretty adventurous.
But I would. Australia is one of the places that frightens me the most, which I know to some people it's just like, why? But everything is just so much bigger and scarier in Australia.
Well, that's because you're not used to it, because they only live in Australia, so you're not used to seeing them. But, rattlesnakes and spiders here you're not afraid of.
That's true.
So, I mean, you know, you just want to stay away from them. You know where they kind of hang out. You just stay away from them. But
if I go to Australia, I'm not going to stay away from them. I'm going to go to the places where they are. You know, I'm not going to go to Australia and just spend the whole day at a hotel. You got to explore.
Well, I mean, I do, but you know, I. Anyway.
Let's
go on to the next clip.
Okay.
And one of the countries we had some time off, and I decided, okay, what are we going to do that's different? So, you know, we spoke about this earlier. We climbed up the side of this mountain, this volcano.
With
sandboards.
Mount Cerro Negro.
And you sandboard down the outside of it. Now, I don't know if people are aware, but volcanic sand is exceptionally sharp,
mm-hmm.
abrasive, and will burn through your clothes.
Ask Susan.
And I have to say, Susie is in our audience. Susie, stand up. Yes, stand up, Susie. Susie, of course, she was there with us, and we all witnessed Joe being very sporting at the very bottom. And whenever he got to the top, it looked like he just wanted shot as he dragged the board behind him.
Yes, because it was one of your tricks. Just a few more feet. Just a few more feet. Hours went by.
It was a good 2-hour climb.
But it was awesome.
Oh, it was
you're
great.
Above
you're
the clouds and you can't really see anything except for his cackling down at the bottom.
Susan was on the board and she started to come down and I was at the bottom and I could watch up. And I seen Susan then cartwheel.
She came off the board.
Oh. And actually cartwheeled. And all she could hear was me on the bottom of the volcano roaring my head and laughter.
That's all I could hear through the clouds is Barry's laughter. Look.
He laughed at you, Susan?
He always does.
Aww.
I hurt myself so much on the show.
I think she hurt her ankle when she got to the top, didn't you?
I did.
Yes. She did. And we did give her first aid.
We did. We wrapped it in something. I can't remember.
It shredded my entire, like, my denim, like, everything.
Oh, that's right.
Shredded. Yeah. Standing right off my ass.
literally. Well, it was everywhere. That stuff got everywhere.
Barry, your dream, the Titanic. Mm-hmm. Yeah, is that something that you're still on your
Absolutely.
Extreme dream list?
Absolutely. You know, speaking to some of the submariners who have already driven mm-hmm. to the Titanic, I became hooked when they said that before they even see the wreck, they're in the darkness. But the hair stands in the back of their necks, the fight or flight in their bodies mm-hmm. engages. And I said, there's something going on down there.
And I mean, I have talked with other people that do underwater investigations, which is a totally mind blower for me. But I mean, how would you get EVP? I mean, how would you record it?
Well, EVP in itself, there's theories out there that it's actually not an air wave,
right?
But more an impression. That's put onto the device.
I see
so
that.
In effect, the EVP, the box can still be encased. It doesn't need
and
to
still,
be in the water.
And still pick up.
Yes.
Okay. All right.
Has anybody ever gotten an underwater EVP that you're aware of?
There have been some. In fact, I was speaking to another submariner who was speaking because he listens to the hydrophones. I think they're called hydrophones.
Yes. Correct.
On the submarines.
Yes.
And he was saying at certain levels of the water, when you hit it correctly, you'll hear screams.
Oh, wow.
And he says, what it is, they're not quite sure, but they're aware of certain levels within water that seems to hold this information.
Well, sound carries over water when you're above the water, so I would assume below the water as well.
Oh, yeah,
well,
sound, yeah. Oh, absolutely.
Much further, yeah.
Fish, yeah, the echolocation, yeah. The dolphins communicate.
Mm-hmm. Whale song, sure.
Yeah, exactly, absolutely.
Yeah. And then we have Paul with Doctor Who.
Oh, okay.
He has a TARDIS.
He built a TARDIS.
Has Doctor Who fans?
And a canine.
I have a robot dog. I have the Dalek. I have the full size. For a long time, actually, my TARDIS was my office.
For a long time.
Was it bigger on the inside?
I wish. No.
No, that doesn't surprise
no.
me.
No. Joe, though, you're interested in cryptozoology, if I'm
yeah,
correct,
I like
right?
cryptozoology. I want to go UFO hunting, Bigfoot hunting, and things like that. So I'm very interested in that.
So I got to know, what's your most, what you think is the most fascinating crypto animal?
Well, I want to find out if there are aliens. I want to see a UFO. I really want to see it. And because I can't believe that we're the only sentient beings in the whole universe.
Well, the two planets they've discovered that are like Earth. Mm. Yeah, so that's an interesting concept. We have that planet and life on those planets.
There's several they've discovered in, yeah, the, in that whole Goldilocks, right. Right. Thing that they talk about. You know.
So that's interesting. It's interesting.
These guys are just so interesting. I had so much fun just talking to them and hearing their stories.
And your bat.
Well, you know.
But you're right. You were right.
Yeah, I sure,
you know,
was.
I mean, they come really close to 5 feet because I'm 5 feet. So yeah, it's, yeah, it's definitely. But I don't think they're scary. I don't look at them as being scary.
No.
They're just big. We're used to the little tiny one.
Exactly.
But yeah.
But I want to go sledding down a volcano now.
You do.
Maybe I'll wear different clothing, you know, to make sure it doesn't totally. But what did Susan say that it
shredded her denims? She had denim jeans on and
down to her bum.
Bum, yeah. Yeah. I don't know. That wouldn't be fun for me. That wouldn't be fun.
Well, I think with the proper sled that you don't fall out of.
Well, then maybe. Yeah, maybe.
Then it would be fun.
I mean, I don't mind hiking up a volcano, but I don't know if I'd want to go sledding down it.
Well, it'd be better than hiking back down.
Why not? It's all downhill.
All right, so yeah. Go ahead.
No, go ahead.
I was going to say, so their next clip is, previously we had talked about their favorite locations.
Right.
Let's talk about their, let's see what they had to say about their worst locations.
We talked about the best locations.
Yeah? Mm-hmm.
Is there a worst?
Yeah, yeah. Some that didn't even make air.
What's the worst one for you that you experienced? Either location, activity, or whatever.
Malaysia. There was a house in Malaysia. What was it called? The Putang Pu?
The Jin House?
Something. Yeah. It was something. Yeah. So what happens is we go in, we're doing the tour, just doing a tour of the location. We get to the top, there's a homeless guy living there.
Oh, yeah.
The poor guy. He had like his stuff was. He had his. He had a job, he just didn't have a home. He had his clothing on a ladder. And he had a little fire cooking some beans, you know, and so we gave him money and sent him to a hotel. And he was very grateful, actually. So yeah, we set him up with a hotel and gave him money and everything so he could get, you know, actually have a shower and get ready and that. But then after the investigation, now bear in mind the company, LA, they do all the, you know, they get the permission slip signed and, you know, the permits to allow us to sign, to film and things like that. Well, it turns out afterwards that the guys who were signing this actually didn't have permission themselves. You know, and through no fault of ours, we were investigating an abandoned house, which we were under the impression this guy had the permission to be in. All the claims were fabricated. They said they saw shadows and it was just cars passing by. It was very obvious. You know, you'd look at it and go, yeah, that's a car. You know, there's a bloody big, great big road there. There was graffiti everywhere. I mean, this place was being, like, they had to go in and clean. They were hiding swastikas against, you know, I mean, it's like, there was, you know, graffiti from everywhere. It was just a horrible, horrible, hot, sweaty location. And it was just one that never made air.
Good. Right for you?
I think for me, I tend to take a look at the complete picture as to, okay, what, you know, as in the country itself, and the experiences that we've had there with the people. I think one of my worst ones would have to have been Transylvania.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, that was before me.
And we were investigating one of Dracula's castles, and it was a hike up 1,649 steps or something like that in 30 degree heat and almost 100% humidity. That was grand, that was okay. You know, to get to the castle, it was a great experience and everything else. But to me, the biggest challenge was the hotel. Because they put us into a hotel and every floor looked the same. There were no numbers to tell you which floor you were on. So it was quite difficult to try and find, number one, your room. And whenever I found my room, it was something almost the size of this. with a little tiny postage stamp TV which sat all the way at the end. And I had this huge big bed, and I shared the air conditioning control with a guy two floors up.
How does that even work?
The shower unit had exposed live wires in it. So as you're taking a shower, you're trying to stay away from the arc that's shooting out. That was all grand, but they had dark corridors, as I said, on the different floors, and it was very, very hard to understand where you were. If there was a fire in the hotel, if you weren't killed by the smoke, you were killed by the Greek Minotaur who was hiding around the corner somewhere. And one particular evening that we were there, I had switched off the light to go to sleep, and the air conditioning unit was on, and that was fine. And all of a sudden, I started hearing this banging. And I thought, what the hell is that? And I felt something hit the bed. And I switched on the light, and this black ooze was flying. It was like something from a haunted movie. This was flying out of the fan unit and being spread over the bed. And it was pouring down the walls and running down onto the lights. I thought, what? What is going on here? And of course, I couldn't get the controller because the guy upstairs was gone. So I had to try and lift this huge bed out, and I was able to get out enough that I could put my arm down the back to reach the socket, and pulled out the socket, and the entire socket came out of the wall with the plug still attached. So I had to go down to reception, and of course they come up and they give out because I had left the air conditioning unit on, and I said, I can't get the controller, I can't switch it off. So there was all this that went on, and they took the towels out of the bathroom, mopped down the bed, and said, there, you go. And that was that.
From
off
hell.
The went.
Oh,
there we go. Yeah.
Uh-huh. I mean, I've had
that could be a new show.
Well, I think Ramsey has one of those shows. Yeah, Ramsey has one of those.
Yeah, he was going to all the good ones.
I've been to some bad hotels, but that one takes the cake.
Yeah, that one takes awful. The cake.
Yeah. Okay, Joe, what was your worst?
I don't know if I had a worst.
Joe's always happy.
Yeah, he's happy-go-lucky, so he probably makes the best out of
it. I make the best of it. Yeah. You know, some of the hotel situations, like Barry's talking about, were problematic at best.
Oh, the Shangri-La in Malaysia. That was awful, wasn't it, Joe?
That was an awful.
That was the best hotel
awesome.
I think we've been in. Right?
So it's not all fun and glamour.
No.
Traveling.
No. No. Oh. And you got to remember, you got a time frame. So you got to, you know, be there. You've got so many hours that you're going to be on the set, and you know, then on your off time, it may be 2 o'clock in the morning, you know, yeah. So, but yeah, they definitely make the best of it. You know?
Yeah, they do. Yeah. Well, I think you have to. You have to kind of have that mindset in order to do something like that,
yeah.
Where you don't even really know where you're going to be next week.
You gotta really love what you do.
You too.
You gotta
you do.
Really love.
Well, I think you really gotta see how the advantage of getting to travel on somebody else's dime, as they had stated earlier. You don't complain when somebody else is paying, right?
Yeah, I can definitely relate with their worst hotels. Anyway, yeah, we think we have one more clip, I think.
So let's let the audience know, because I think you all know that Ghost Hunter International is no longer filming new shows. They are still airing. But now that it's no longer in production, what are each of you doing? If you want to let everyone know where they can expect to see you pop up next.
Okay. Well, I keep busy with two paranormal teams back home that I belong to, TAPS, and of course, Rise Up Paranormal. I also film a TV show in Pennsylvania called The Paranormal After Party. It's down in the Pennsylvania area, shown on CW and Fox 56. You can watch the episodes on YouTube or paranormalafterparty.tv or on YouTube. So I keep very busy with investigations, filming for that, and doing events.
Great.
This might take a little longer.
That's okay, Barry. We got time. I edit.
I've been writing a series of books, Legend Seekers, and a new one that's going to hit the market in April, and it's called The Council of Three. That really examines a lot of our ancient history, what our ancestors were doing on all the lands around the world, and about how they were opening the doorway to these other places, and also the dangers to doing that. We have a TV show in the works for Legend Seekers, which examines the ancient legends of Ireland and how they affect us today on the land. I'm also doing a documentary on the Sligo Hum. And this is a sound which is being heard right across the world, in the US, in the UK, in Australia. And this noise is coming from the earth itself. Mm-hmm. And up onto the land, and I've been interviewing people right across the world for this. And it's been intriguing because even this year itself, we've had 33 whales beach themselves along our west coast. And that is huge for us. And this is a sound which has started now several years ago. I've got to hear it for myself, and it can plague you in your sleep. This low vibration will come in the night, and it'll penetrate. We sleep in a house with 200 years old, with walls that thick, they're stone, and it has no problem in penetrating that house. And other people in the area are hearing it as well. So there's a huge mystery around that as to why this is happening and the connections to it. The first time I got to hear it, I was writing my book, Searching the She, which took me to areas where the Irish fairy, those original stories were being found and told. So I spent the night in these different locations. And one particular night by this huge big cavern, that's when I got to hear it. Yeah. And rather than the sound coming through the air, it was coming through the mountain. And that amazed me completely. And I've got the ghost cruises that are happening as well. Yeah. We're just back from the Caribbean ghost cruise.
I've been dying to get on one of those.
And it was absolutely amazing. We got to go back to Jamaica, the Cayman Islands, and we also were at Cozumel for the Mayan ruins.
You got anything coming intriguing. Up out of New Orleans?
We're trying. We're trying. We are looking into it. We are looking into it.
That's the one I want.
And we're delving. The ghost cruise delves into many things, such as cryptids and also ufology. So we're looking at a European cruise as well that will take us to locations that are presently active, and really have our European scientists scratching their heads. So that's happening as well.
Interesting. Paul,
I'm doing nothing.
Nothing at all.
Oh, no, that's not true. That's not true. No, you're into. You and Barry are both into photography, and also, and I was going to ask you earlier about this. I wasn't sure if I should bring it up. There was a movie, Southwest.
That was me. Yeah.
What happened?
Oh, and you? You were in there.
I was in it as a drunken Irishman.
Exactly.
How stereotypical, yeah.
Yeah.
What happened to that? It was released in 2013, but I never saw it.
I don't know what happened to the movie. The series hit though. They did a TV series, a spin-off based off of the movie, that actually hit. It was Bounce TV or something. It's one of these channels that comes with like a network with a provider and that. So it did air for a while. I mean, there was a couple of episodes. I mean, I don't know exactly where it went.
It looked good.
It was all right. I mean, I was an FBI agent with a British accent. I mean, that was
what else?
A bit random, you know. At least he got to be Irish. I don't know. Yeah, I mean, I got to die a couple of times.
A couple of times?
Yeah.
Oh, and I got to kill Spock in the
bath. Oh, you did? You killed Spock?
Yeah.
Oh, I got waterboarded.
Well, is it available on DVD? Is it available on Amazon?
I've been trying to get the DVD and such for it, but I mean, communication with anything out of Hollywood or anything like that is always a nightmare. Especially when actually I think he's in Nevada, so I don't know why I'm writing to Hollywood. That's probably why I'm not getting any responses. But yeah, I don't know. I mean, I've been trying and hopefully I can get something out of him because, you know, for conventions and events and things like that, this sort of thing is great.
Yeah.
I did a documentary a little while ago. I think Joe was in part of that one.
What was that?
That was Brian Kano's thing. He did like a Ghost Hunters 101 type thing. And he interviewed a lot of different people. And I don't know what happened to that one either. There's a lot of these things going around that just sort of you participate in, and I guess some point they'll show up at some point.
But you're still keeping busy because you're still building, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So this is the guy to go to for tech, for ghost hunting tech.
Well, before I was with GHI, I was building tech. Whilst I was with GHI, I was still building different tech and things like that. And now I continue to build ghost hunting equipment for Ghost Stop. Last September, we launched Boo Buddy, which is the interactive ghost hunting bear.
Can't wait to get mine.
I'm actually one of the inventors of that.
You're gonna save me one, right? You're not gonna.
There's three
one.
Left.
Good, you're gonna three yeah, save
okay.
me.
Okay.
You better run right afterwards.
I know, I'm going to run right after.
There's Boo Buddy. We did the 360 rig that was on Ghost Hunters recently. The three GoPro rig with the IR 360 IR puck. I call it the puck, the IR puck.
I haven't seen that yet.
It's a modular system. It was on Ghost Hunters last season. Essentially what it is a puck system, a module system, which has a ring of infrared. You can have a ring of lasers as well. You can buy them in parts and they just sort of snap together and things like that. And then the top piece is a three camera mount for something like your GoPros or your whatever, you know, your little action cameras and stuff. And you can put that in the middle of a room and you can get the whole room then, you know?
Yeah, what's the radius and how far does it shoot out?
The IR will do 50 feet each way.
Oh, wow.
So something like 1,000 something square feet, I think it works
that's
out.
That's a lot.
It is a lot.
That's huge.
Yeah, that's what she said.
So that's Ghost Stop.
Ghost Stop, yes. GhostStop.com.
And there's your Boo
and
Buddy.
And there's my Boo Buddy. And there's my Boo Buddy. See my Boo Buddy? Yeah, this is what he was talking about. And it actually works. I had a chance to use it this last investigation. So we've got to go over the evidence, and if it works, you will certainly hear about it. But yeah.
So now we have one more segment.
Yes, one more segment to wrap it up.
Yeah, we did offer the audience some time to ask questions mm-hmm. to these guys, maybe things that we hadn't thought of. So let's watch that clip and see where it goes. No, let's do some audience questions. I already saw some hands go up at different points, so I will. Okay.
I've always wondered.
Hold on. Yep. First of all, tell me your name.
My name's Craig Squires.
Thank you.
I've watched your show, and I've always wondered, when you're on location in a predominantly non-English speaking place, do you expect them to speak to you in English?
We always went into this, Craig, with the understanding that to try and reach some spirits, because we had seen this in Romania as well, to try and reach some spirits, it's best if we use some of the native language as well. Mm-hmm. However, with editing, the editors had no idea what the hell we were asking. So they would never include that in the show. So from your guys' standpoint, you've seen us speaking English, but we actually spoke, we took phrases in with us in the native language, and we utilized that as well. But again, editors had no idea what we were talking about, so they couldn't subtitle it.
The other argument was that predominantly our audience is English speaking, and so they wanted to maintain an English speaking show. So even though we even got to the stage where we were like, every time we went to another country, I actually went to receptionists and I asked them specifically, can you write down a couple of these phrases for me in a way that I would just be able to read it? Not how is it spelled in your language, but how is it spelled if you said it just verbally, you know? And I had a bunch of stuff and I would then give that list to production so that they knew what we were talking. But ultimately, because we were an English show for an English speaking audience, that's pretty much how they edited it. But yeah, I've spoken probably 1,000 different languages, all with a British accent. And I've probably butchered 1,000 different languages. But ultimately, like Barry says, it comes down to the editing in the end. But we all did do it.
Thank you. Who else has a question? Okay. I got two of you over here. Okay. Hello again.
Hi.
Tell us your name one more time.
Jeff George.
Thank you, Jeff. Who's your question for?
All of them, really, if
okay.
I could.
Go ahead.
You've mentioned your favorite places, your worst places. What about your scariest situations?
Excellent question.
That hotel sounds scary to me.
Yeah. The castle in Denmark frightened me because I didn't know that ghosts could bite you and leave an impression. A place, I think we were in Germany at the fortress where it got bombed and bodies couldn't be recovered. And as we got up to the top of the, I guess.
No, that was Belgium.
Belgium.
Yeah.
And we got to the top of this mountain on Belgium where the debris still was visible, where all of a sudden I get an overwhelming emotional response. You know, Scott and I were laughing and joking, but right when I got to that spot, I got this overwhelming feeling of sadness and sorrow that I broke down on camera, and I couldn't help it. Tears were pouring down, and I couldn't stop. It took me 45 minutes to compose myself, so that kind of scared me a little, that I couldn't have control of my emotions. So that was unnerving for me.
I think for me, I was with Dustin Perry, and there were several different locations, but this one in particular stands out to me because I was with Dustin in the Philippines, and it was Clark Air Force Base that we were in. And Dustin and I were working, and you know, there were various different things that were happening. We were able to establish that there was spirit on the upper floors, but Dustin and I wanted to concentrate our efforts in the basement of this place. And I have to say that we came against something there, and that was really wrong. There was something that was completely wrong. And moments before, our cameraman was starting to wonder what the hell's happening, Snapper. And I said, Dustin, we need to get the hell out of here. And the bats, there were thousands of bats that were flying around, and all of a sudden they stopped. And there was just an overwhelming sense of something very wrong down there. And I don't know what it was. I didn't want to open myself up to it. I says, no, this is beyond ghosts. There's something more here. And it says, we need to leave. And we did. And that was one of the places that really stands out to me that I would prefer not to go back to.
There's only been two times in my history of GHI where I've got that whole fight or flight thing kicks in and suddenly I'm about to punch a ghost. The first time was in Poland with Barry, actually. We were investigating Hitler's bunker, and we had everything in that particular, but we had every piece of equipment out of those cases and in this area, and we were playing music, and the hairs on my arms were standing up, my back of my neck. It was like I was being watched. There was something wandering around and like knocking the leaves down as it was wandering around. You could hear it moving. And then there was this part of the bunker that had fallen, because the Russians went in there and just blew all these bunkers up. I don't know if you know the location, but it was where the Operation Valkyrie, the Wolf's Lair, so where they tried to assassinate Hitler with the briefcase under the desk, and the desk took the blow and Hitler survived. But ultimately, the Russians went in and they blew all these bunkers apart. So there's bits of bunker just lying everywhere. And there's this one that looked almost like a cave. And I just, for whatever reason, I just knew something was going to come out there and, I don't know, just attack us or something. Nothing did, but I just had that feeling. And then the second time was in Italy, where Susan and I were investigating this upper level of the fortress. And there was stones being thrown actually, I wasn't scared so much there because they were being thrown at Susan. But there was this, the thing is, it got thrown, there was three stones got thrown, and progressively each time they got bigger. And it started off with like, you know, just almost like a pebble. But then it got to like a broken bit of brick. And then the next piece was almost like a piece of the building. You know, it was like, it got to a piece about this big. And at that point, I was actually doing my interview. So I had my camera guy was in front of me, the audio guy and the producer, they were there, and Susan was sitting on the floor, because at this point she's already had stones thrown at her twice. So she's sitting on the floor there. I'm talking to the producer and the camera's like looking at me, and we're talking, and at that point this what looks like a small piece of the building just comes down, hits the floor, bounces up and hits Susan. It's like whatever it was aiming at Susan, and there was nobody else around. All of us were in this room, and that kind of scared the crap out of me at that point. Again, I just don't know why I'm going to punch a ghost. You know, but that was the only other times that actually, like, I felt like there's something's going to happen. That room was weird. I think even during, I think just before I did my interview, something pulled my backpack. I had my back to the door, and I even said to them I didn't want to do the interview there, because I didn't want my back to that door. And they're like, why not? I said, well, because there's monsters in there. I don't freaking know, but you know, because there's a monster in the room. But no, it was, I just, you know, but and sure as heck, as I started the interview, my back gets pulled back, and I was like, see, I told ya. It's funny because they use that for the intro for, you know, when they do, you know, join us next week when GHI investigates and such like that, and you see me going like this, and it's like, great, Paul punches a ghost.
One more over here. Your name, sir?
I am Vince Nealon, and I'm an investigator with CCPI. That's actually Jackie's group. I'm proud to be a member, believe me. Anyway, this is probably a tech question. What do you think of apps? Yes. Like right now, Steve Huff, you've heard of Steve Huff?
Right.
Okay, and the SCD-1 that's out right now, is it actually reliable enough
for
you
to get behind it? Ultimately, it's software, it's a game. Your phone is a phone, and each phone varies, okay? Yes, they have a vibration detection, they have their magnetometers inside them and such, but they vary from each one. I think apps are not reliable. You've got a bunch of things out there. I mean, there are ways that an app can be useful, in that it does detect vibration. It has a very slight understanding of EMF, things like that. You need the hardware, which the phone doesn't have. You need additional hardware in order. There's the Mr. Ghost. I don't know if anybody have ever heard of the Mr. Ghost, which was basically an antenna which would actually translate the frequencies. It would actually translate the frequencies into a readout. So rather than just it reading from the microphone and you getting everything, it was actually looking for specific stuff. But even then, it was somewhat unreliable. You'd get three or four of them together, and they would show different results. I don't know. I mean, do I have any apps? I have an app. I have one.
One last question I wanted to ask. You guys, I mean, not only with GHI, right? But you've gone off. You've done your own thing. You've made strides. You're passionate. You're committed. What would you want people to take away from you, not only as GHI, but as a photographer, as a cryptozoologist, as a legend seeker? What would you like people to know and take away from your work?
I'd say that if you're into the paranormal, listen to your body, don't rely heavily on equipment, and just soak it all in.
Experience it.
Experience it.
Experience it. Barry, what about you?
I think for me, from my work, I would like people to take away that we should learn to slow down. Our lives are becoming faster and faster and faster, and we are not communicating with each other anymore. We're not taking in what our neighbors do. We're not communicating. We put in earbuds into our ears, and we isolate ourselves into this bubble, and we see the world here. We're not seeing the bigger picture. And certainly for my work, to step back and see that bigger picture, my mind has been blown off my shoulders of this new world of mystery that I've started to stumble into. So my message would be, slow down, respect each other, and learn to listen again.
Good, good words. Paul?
These guys are kind of taking all the good answers. But, you know, I mean, you know, they both do very, very much have very, very valid points in that, you know, we spend our social lives now are social media. That's basically how we socialize. It's all through computers and things like that. We need to come away from that stuff. I think one of the things that in my travels and my experience and my meeting people that we really need to hone in on is common sense. I think far too many people are out there just going with it, and without really thinking what they're doing, they see something on television and they mimic it. And you've got to realize that what you saw us doing was edited down. You know, we don't just go into these locations, sit around, ask questions for 20 minutes, and then go back, review the evidence, and then, you know, reveal everything. It's a very long process. There's a lot more involved in what we do, and I think common sense is something which a lot of people seem to lack. So, you know, again, it could just be because, you know, you're not opening your eyes, you're not taking in the world around you. You do have maybe too much tech or something like that, but, you know, there's always a balance. You know, I mean, I'm always on Facebook. I'm just as bad. But ultimately, there is a balance, and there are times when you just turn off the tech and take in the world. That's, and I try and do that through my photography as well. So,
I think you guys hit it on the head. I really do. I really do. Because, you know, keeping it simple, keeping a balance, experiencing it. Don't let all the other stuff interfere with that. Okay?
Okay.
That's it.
All right, guys. Thank you so much for joining us up here today. Thank you.
I love you guys.
I know. They're so great. Thank you so much. All right. Thank you all for participating, for joining with us.
That's been really great for our first location shoot.
Yeah.
That's been great. So give yourself a hand. Very good. All right.
All right, guys.
Oh, whoa. You had fun. I had so much fun.
I had too.
I mean, I was wiped by the time it was all said and done.
Yes.
And, I mean, I didn't even go on the investigation because I was just, and it was hot, and I was just so tired.
Yeah.
But it was a good tired, you know what I mean?
It was a good tired.
And I hope we get to do more. I want to do more.
It really was really cool to get out of the studio and to get on the location and to talk to people. It was so...
For our first one, we couldn't ask for better hosts, better guests on our show.
Right.
So,
or a better crew, for that matter.
Better crew. Oh, yeah. Well, you can't forget the crew.
I know.
Oh, my God. If I forget the crew, they'll hang me by my toes. No, we have a super crew. And just to reiterate, I just want to thank them because, I mean, this is all volunteer, folks. Nobody gets paid for this. They do it because they love it, and they love us, and they love the show. So, you know, thank you to all of them.
Yeah.
Anyway.
So I guess that's pretty much wraps it up for us, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So as always, check out CCPI website to see what they're on to. That's ccpifresno.org. You can see what I'm doing at sacredlightreiki.com. And we will see you back for our next show, where we will talk about more paranormal topics, if I can spit these words out. We are on the last Wednesday of each month, same time, same channel. We hope that you've enjoyed our show. And if you like what you've seen so far, go to our Facebook page, give us a like, leave comments, whatever interaction you want to have with us. You can ask us questions, and also we have links to all of our past shows there. And don't forget to like the page, and that is facebook.com/paranormaljourneys. And that is it for today. So take care, everyone.
And be safe.